In chapter 8 of Bhagavad Gita, Bhagwan has proceeded to give an introduction to himself, which he has already given in already started in chapter 7. Because if we remember, in Bhagavad Gita, chapters 2 to 6 is all about the jiva swabhava, the swabhava of the individual. Who is he? Is he this bundle of decaying flesh or the fickle mind? Or is he the divine consciousness? And that has been proved and amply explained up to chapter 6. And also the methods of realizing that highest self that we are, the divine consciousness and nothing more. But from 7th chapter onwards, Bhagwan has proceeded to introduce himself, to say, yes, tat tvam asi, we know your swabhava, and now my swabhava. So finally the Mahavakya tat tvam asi will be explained. Tat tvam asi means you are the same tattva as mine. And what is that mind, the Krishna's tattva? So in chapter 7, he had already said, Aham Krishnasya Jagata Prabhavah Pralayas Tatha. I am the source and the dissolution of the entire universe. Meaning to say, I am that seed from which everything sprouts. I am that avyakta, the unmanifest, from which this entire manifest world springs forth. And therefore, the tattva of the unmanifest consciousness and the tattva of all this manifest world, including us jiva, is the same. And in the 7th chapter, he had also proceeded, as he introduced himself, the param tattva, is that mai sarvamidam protam sutre manigana iva. I am that invisible force, that invisible power, that has strung the entire earth, the entire cosmos, in fact, together like pearls on a string, which means everything is in complete order. It is completely, the entire universe follows certain laws. And those laws are, certainly there has to be someone to govern the laws. So I am the one who governs and I am the one who orders this world. So I am the one who has placed complete order in the world, the laws of karmic, the karmic laws and the physical laws of the world. They go in perfect scientific, they follow the perfect scientific process. They never seem to differ from it. Now, who is the one who orders these laws? Certainly, I am that sutra, that string, that strings these so-called diverse pearls together. So there's a great deal of diversity in the world, and it seems as if everything is diverse and distinct and unrelated in nature and in people, but actually they are all strung together, and the common thread running through everything is consciousness. That common thread, I am, he had explained that. That means that he is that conscious power, at least in the sentient beings. He is that buddhir buddhimatam asmi tejas tejas vinam aham, in the sentient beings. And I am also existence, which means everything in this world at least shares one thing in common, that it exists. So I am existence and I am consciousness. Slowly he is unraveling his own nature. And therefore, we find in chapter 9, I mean in chapter 8, verse number 9, he says, Kavin Purana Manushasitaram, I am omniscient, ancient ruler, Anorani Yasa Manusmaredyaha, I am also subtler than the Anu, subtler than the atom, Sarvasya Dhataram Achintya Rupam, Dhataram, I am the nourisher, the Adharam, the substratum of everything. So that's one common thread. Achintya Rupam, inconceivable. So I am not to be conceived through the senses, because the senses are gross. and they belong to the body, and so does the mind. They are also in the gross realm. Although it is the subtle body, mind and intellect, they still cannot conceive me. You cannot conceive me through the mind and the body and the intellect. So I am achintya rupam, inconceivable. Aditya varnam, that's where we had stopped. Aditya varnam meaning I am like the sun. So literal translation would be that I am the sun. And therefore we find a lot of sun worship in a lot of civilizations, including the Egyptian civilization. And we have just finished one big festival called the Chhat Puja, which is celebrated with a lot of pomp and ceremony in the north of India. So this Chhat Puja, actually, if we ask these millions of people who throng to the water bodies despite corona, despite the restrictions, and they fought tooth and nail to get to the water bodies, why is it? Now, I wonder how many of them would actually know what the significance of this sun worship is. It's quite simple. It's not that the sun is literally the god, it is symbolizing something. And I am Aditya Varnam, it means, first thing, the sun is literally the source of all life on earth, in the sense that it is because of the sun that we have vegetation and therefore nourishment on this earth. And therefore we are also, we would not be able to live ourselves without sunlight. So there, it is a source of nourishment, of growth, of life. And without that, there is no life. So also consciousness. If there is no consciousness, we would be just inert stones, like on planets which are far away from the sun, at least the sun of this particular galaxy. So our sun is at the exact right distance for there to be life on earth. So it's life-giving, so is consciousness. It is self-effulgent, meaning to say you don't need another sun to light it up. The sun doesn't need a torch to light itself up to say, okay, let me see what I look like. It is self-effulgent, so is consciousness. We can know the mind, we can know the body through the senses. Okay, this is my hand, this is my arm. We can know the mind because we can observe what is going on in the mind, that intellect is observing. We can still know what is going on in the intellect because there is another observer. How would otherwise we know what is going on in our own mind and intellect if the observer was not somebody else? You saw some body, it's not a body, okay, but some other entity. Now, because that observer, that Sakshi, is distinct from the mind and body, we are able to observe our own mind and body. Who is that observer? And who can light it up? Can you see that observer? Do you need another light to observe that observer? No. That observer, that Sakshi, that consciousness is ever present, and it needs only itself. It cannot be lighted up by another light. That means it cannot be known by another source. I know my mind and my body and my senses through some source, but that original source can only know itself. So it is self-effulgent. So consciousness is self-effulgent. If that consciousness was not there, we would not exist. In the sense, without consciousness, we cannot function. So whether we are in deep sleep or in waking, or even if we are in a coma, there is this common thread of consciousness running through us. And it is never, even if we are asleep or in deep sleep or in meditation or in samadhi, that's deep meditation, that consciousness is not absent. It never ever leaves us. It never ever, in every state, whether it is in darkness or in light, or whether we are outdoors or indoors or asleep or awake or busy or not busy, aware of it or not aware of it. Most of the time we are not aware of it because we are so busy and so loud and so boisterous in the world. But it still exists. It does not go dim. It is continuous, and therefore that's why it is tamasav parastat, meaning there is no thing called darkness for the sun. Literally meaning tamasav parastat means no such thing as darkness for the sun. What about the consciousness? Exactly, that's what it is. It's always existent. in all states. Therefore, what is this sun worship, this Chhat Puja that we were talking about? Oh, it is the symbol, because Surya has some of the qualities of consciousness. Some, not all, because sun by itself is also a Nashwar body, which means after millions and billions of years, like any other star or astral body, it's cosmic body, it's also going to fall apart and go cold and destroy. And then there will be another world, another Srishti. So, to that extent, it is not like consciousness, but many of the qualities are common. And therefore, worshipping Aditya or the sun is like worshipping, or like it's like a constant remembrance of that self-effulgent, constant consciousness which is part of us and which is life-giving. Buddhir buddhimatam asmi tejas vidna hatam. So I am that tejas, that buddhi, otherwise without that nothing can exist. That symbolism has in many cases taken a kind of a turn towards superstition and outer practice and too much involvement in outer practices. One also sometimes obscures the original idea, the original truth, and the original remembrance of that consciousness, that God, because there's too much of activity outside and too much of emphasis on the norms and practices. So the common man, yes, does get involved in that, but it's good to know what are these symbols that we are engaging in. So that's all about Aditya Varnam. That is my Varna. How can I reach that highest truth? Is it through these noisy pujas and archanas and rituals? And so ritualism has its purpose, definitely, to an extent, in the sense that it draws us away from the sansari attractions and helps us to concentrate on those symbols, provided we know what those symbols are. But the ritualism by itself, action by itself, are made by the gross body, and therefore the gross can never lead us to the subtlest. That's a common logic, actually. So what can reach us towards that that highest knowledge? What is it if not rituals, if not even just reading? Because I can read the Gita umpteen number of times and that is just a verbal knowledge for me. So neither the reading nor the listening, verbal listening, and nor the ritualistic outward physical practices and puja and archana and havan and karma kand. No, Shankaracharya is very clear that karma kand is a kind of hypocritic. He has used strong words, I must say. Pakhand, he has said. Then that leaves us only with one thing. And that is when we go beyond this gross body. And the gross body actually is functioning within what? Within the medium of time and space. I'm going into a little bit of Einsteinian world of science to say that our body definitely functions within the space and time medium. But when we are in meditation, when we are in deep meditation, what is it that happens to our body? We are, of course, not aware of it at that particular moment. So how can we reaching the God through the body? No. What about the mind? The mind also has been transcended. We are not aware of it. If we are in deep meditation, if we know that highest type of meditation which comes to the adept practitioners, we may not have reached that level of adept practice, but that is the promise of meditation. The promise of meditation is that when there is no mind, then, I mean awareness of mind, like in sleep, then how can the agitations or the troubles of the mind trouble us? They cannot, because we are beyond the mind, beyond the intellect, and beyond the body. That, and because we are beyond these, in the sense not aware of these, that awareness itself remains, but where is the time and space? So until we come back to awareness, to awakening, awakening meaning awakening of wakefulness, we are away from time and space too. So being away from time and space actually means to be in the lap of the Lord. That is a bhakti language. In the lap of the Lord actually means to be in that medium or in that tattva or in that zone, let's say. That zone where Bhagwan exists, and for him there is no time and no space. So this has also been researched by many, many scientists. You can imagine how time exists. It has been described in science as well as Vedanta that time is nothing but the interval between two incidents. Where do the incidents take place? They take place in space. That I have this distance, I have to travel from here to America, so there is a certain distance, it will take so much time. So when there is an activity between two incidents, that's where time exists. And then you say, okay, so it's going to take 17 hours or 18 hours. If there is no activity, if there is no space, if there is no experience, let's say, yes, experience, then there is no space and no time. So space and time exist only when there is an experience. So it's a slightly subtle thing, but quantum physics, if we get into quantum physics, this idea has been explained amply. But in simple terms, for us common people, let's just come down to the basic idea that to go beyond time and space, meditation is the simplest method for us, ordinary people. And that's when we don't let the world invade our mind. We don't let the experiences of the world invade our senses, let's say. And therefore, in that zone, in that meditation, Bhagwan says, in that space, you are like me. You are me, actually, because you exist in a medium of pure awareness. We are pure awareness in those moments. And therefore, he says, you are me, tattvam asi. And so then, what is it that we seek from the world? To be happy. In that state, there is no word called happy because there is a state of complete bliss. So that blissfulness is my own true nature, and that is who you are. So you are Sat, constantly existing, Chit, and you are aware, always aware. That awareness doesn't leave you, consciousness doesn't leave you. You are never in darkness in that sense, and you are always blissful. Because in deep meditation, how can you know sorrow when you are not in contact with your own senses or the mind or the intellect, which is actually the transacting counter of interacting with the world? So the world sorrows or experiences don't rush in. Simple. Because that counter is closed. The shutters are down. So the shop window is closed. You're saying, okay, so the world cannot disturb you and therefore there is no sorrow. So what can I do to gain happiness? Oh, nothing. You are happiness and nothing can make you happier. Happier is a relative term. There is no such thing. Blissfulness is a completeness in itself. So just as the post we saw this morning, it was a beautiful post where the wife is asked, has this man made you happy, the husband? Has he made you happy through life? And she answers quite firmly. She says, no. To everyone's surprise. That was a beautiful post. No, so everyone is surprised. And her answer is extremely Vedantic, very, very spiritual. She says, how can somebody, anybody, whether it is a father, son, spouse, how can my happiness ride on somebody else's actions? I am of the nature of happiness. It was a Vedantic truth, which the wife was actually enumerating. She says, this man is happy. I am also happy, and I was happy before I married. Some people get married because they feel that they will attain happiness by that action or that experience. It's not only marriage. People go into a lot of experiences like travel or a whole lot of things, imagining that happiness lies in that experience. But even J. Krishnamurti used to say, he would say, Don't get married to be happy. But if you are already happy and complete, then you may get married. That's when the relationship will be wholesome. And that's exactly what happens. My happiness, says the wife, does not depend on the fluctuations on somebody else's mind. I am happiness per se. Full stop. There is no happiness because of. So it is not a dependent happiness. And therefore, it's not relative. Therefore, if you notice, everything in the nature of our true nature, that is our true nature, which is Sat, existence, is not relative. We exist irrespective of whether the cosmos exists or doesn't exist. We still exist. We as in the consciousness. And we are always aware. That awareness doesn't need another light to illumine it. And therefore, that is also not relative. And our anand, the bliss that we are talking about, is also not relative. Therefore, irrespective of what goes on in this ever-changing jagat, and the nature of jagat or sansar is to change, to modify, to decay, and to transform. That is its nature. But Sat Chit Anand is not relative to anything. And that completeness and fulfillment, Bhagwan says, is my nature as well as yours. And therefore, Tattvamasi, you are that same Tattva. By this logic, he has drawn us to the fact that that nothing in you really is relative. You are already complete. And therefore, there is already an absence of desire in you. Because in that state, in that zone of completeness, there is no there's no way one can want something or be desirous for something. Yes, as jivas living in this world, as materialistic, consumeristic people who we believe we are this body, this mind, and this aham, this ahankar. The moment you believe and identify with this body, you say, okay, I am this body, mind and intellect, then the desire arises. So that space inside, that zone inside is actually uncontaminated. It's uncontaminated if we realize it. Otherwise, yes, it is it can be troublesome. That's how grief is brought in. But Bhagwan has in the 8th chapter also said that uncontaminated space is me. So you're not reaching somewhere else to know yourself or to be yourself or to reach the truth or to find God. You may phrase it any way you like, but the idea is that where you are, that completeness is. So in the third verse of chapter 8, Bhagwan had already said, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Aksharam Brahma Paramam Swabhavodhyatma Mochyate. I am that Akshara. Akshara means to be destroyed. Aksharam cannot be destroyed. I am that Akshara, that imperishable and that supreme. Okay. Now going ahead, some more introduction into the nature of God, because 7th chapter onwards, we are discovering Paramatma. But remember, by discovering Paramatma, we are also discovering ourselves, because our Tattva is the same. So now we will move to chapter 8, verse 11. Yadaksharam Veda Vido Vadanti, Yadaksharam Veda Vido Vadanti, Vishanti Yadyatayo Vitaragaha, Yadichanto Brahmacharyam Charanti, Tate Padam Sangrahena Pravakshe. That which is imperishable, which is the supreme, into that, the self-control, the desire-free, enter that zone, that space, which is completely self-controlled. It actually doesn't need control. Control is when there is some external force or some external element being included. But we don't need any external element to be included in our pure nature of Sat, existence, Chit, consciousness, Anand, bliss. This is our only introduction, actually. If you say, what is your first name, middle name and last name, that's what it is of every human being, Sat Chit Anand. And therefore, there is no external force, and therefore there is no desire. that desiring for which brahmacharya is practiced. Now, the desire, if we have to have any desire, let's have the desire for that highest truth, for knowing this subtlest and highest and most supreme truth. Yes, it is subtle, but let's at least hold that desire. It is equally difficult to have a baby, but people do have babies. It's equally, there's a lot of hardship involved in having a new home or a big home or a big car or a big business. Yes, equally difficult, but people do have desire for it and do make an effort for it. So why say that, attaining this highest truth is a bit too abstract, and what is that God and what is the truth about myself? It's a bit hard for me. Yes, so is everything else in the world, but we do aspire and work for those things. So there's no logic in saying that goal is not mine. In fact, there is only one goal, and the goal is to find ourselves and find Bhagwan. So Gita actually is the essence, the very cream of all the Upanishads, because Upanishads only roar forth this declaration from the rooftops that Tattva Masi, Aham Brahma Asmi, there is one Tattva that exists in everything, and that is the essence of all Vedas. Gita is the cream of that Upanishad. So Gita also goes one step forward and offers us a GPS, as I mentioned. It offers us a geographical positioning system, GPS, so that we can ground ourselves and find our way. But if we are not ready for such a big leap to know what is Brahma, then we need to understand where to start. And Bhagwan has only said, why don't you make brahmacharya your goal in life? Meaning to say, all the worldly goals are fine, they will take care of themselves. You give them their due space, and everything has a due space. Like we have dharma, artha, kama, moksha as our purushartha in the world. So we do our dharma. To some extent, we follow our duties, and artha is a big 80% to have a big security and material security in finances, and material acquisition is artha, kama, to gain pleasures. Now 100% almost taken up in this, no space for moksha. Bhagwan is saying, make brahmacharya. Brahmacharya here stands for walking in the path of Brahma, walking in search of Brahma. Charati. For what? Charati, walking for Brahma. That's the literal meaning of brahmacharya, not celibacy, which is the implied meaning. And there you will find the highest silence. Brahmacharati, the highest silence. How? How can we ever reach that highest silence when we are not used to meditation, when we are not used to bringing in our scattered mind down and making it one, combining it and sort of making it in union with the body where it is, bringing it back? That highest silence, do we know it? That highest meditation, do we know it? Then how can we gain the highest goal? It will require, just as acquiring material goals requires some kind of sacrifice, some kind of effort, some kind of giving up a few other things. I don't meet my relatives so very often. I don't have time so much for a whole lot of other things, because my worldly goal may be to do well in my business or in my profession. So even for my profession, in the worldly sense, I do renounce a whole lot of other pleasures. I don't take holidays for 2 years at a stretch, for example, just giving an example. Therefore, Bhagwan says, without any renunciation, how can you even expect to gain the highest goal? Even for your smaller little goals, you are practicing renunciation, renouncing this or that pleasure or, you know, luxury for yourself. So renunciation of a material life, renunciation of some of the driving desires which are driving us like wild horses, and renunciation of the notion that this world is permanent and I will gain permanent happiness and bliss from it, is a mistaken notion from which I need to renounce my mind. And therefore Bhagwan says, without silence, there's no meditation. Without enunciation, there's no meditation. Without meditation, we cannot know the difference between what's really important for me to chase in life and what is unimportant. I cannot even have that vivek. Vivek is that ability to discern, and that distance, vairagya. So what do I do about the world? What comes naturally to us? Accept it. What comes naturally? It's not that desires are not there, but those desires, if they are tossing us in agitation, then with each tossing desire, with each driving desire, what's happening to us? We are losing our potential. To that extent, our potential to reach that highest goal is diminished. So we are actually making our strength, our vitality. Actually, in the 10th verse, even pran had been mentioned, control over your pran shakti. Our pran shakti, the vital living force, is actually scattered in a whole lot of things. Even in the involuntary functions like blood circulation and digestion and circulation of the body, of the blood, all that is also taking our pran shakti. And plus, what is taking away our strength is our mind, which is even more scattered in the world. So we are actually, by the time we get down to meditation or looking for satya or looking for God or finding out about the truth, even verbally, like now, like reading about it, we are by then completely exhausted. Exhausted meaning the pran shakti has already been expended. That pran shakti, Bhagwan says, you can conserve. Conserve it. How? By doing what is the minimum in the world. Of course, we live in the world. We have our duties, our dharma towards our families and profession and positions. And not to stretch it to fill our 24 hours. No. To keep a sort of proportionate value for it in life and complete it and then come back to ourselves. You know, like people who have this driving hobby, or like painting or cooking or art or dance, what they do is they're in a hurry to complete all the other tasks and then return back to the things they love, to the art or the craft or the... So meditation is like that. Meditation or the love for God, let's say. Love for God is like that. When we complete our duties, we are in a hurry to conserve our energy in the world, not to scatter it and come back. The problem is that in meditation, we may empty our minds and say that, okay, no more experiences, I'm not collecting any more new experiences, and I have reduced my interaction or extrovertedness in the world. Fine. Once we have reduced our extrovertedness, etc., in the world, we can still say that in times of meditation, or when the body is quiet, let's say forcibly through meditation, we are letting in past experiences explored and explore our minds. Even if we collect no new experiences, the mind is so tricky, it starts to dwell in past experiences. Those experiences which are already gone and passed, and bring them back into the present meditative mind. So we have to be careful even when we renounce and reduce our experiences. Even those of the past, the mind need not regurgitate. That is, because in that regurgitating of the past experiences, first of all, it's a futile activity. It's all past, dead and gone. And secondly, it consumes our pran shakti, our vital pran, our pran shakti, which we need for meditation, for seeking the God. So in the 10th verse, he had already said that, can you please have four things with you always? Abhyasa. Abhyasa means, this abhyasa actually doesn't mean a mechanical repetitive practice. Okay, that becomes a habit, that's good. But abhyasa means that we go into any practice, spiritual practice, we go into any spiritual practice with the idea that I am Atma. So that Atma Drishti is never forgotten. So Abhyas means don't go into mechanical practice, but hold the Atma Drishti. I am the Atma. Then I can do some Abhyasa. And then what is the second Abhyasa? Okay, second Abhyasa is to be aware. What are my triggers in this world? Triggers meaning what are the situations and people and situations, people and practices and events which are leading to eruption of raga attachment and dvesha in me. In me, raga dvesha is caused by what? Who can be aware of it? Only we can be aware of it. And therefore, having that Atma Drishti and watching our raga dvesha becomes a habit, abhyasa. So abhyasa also needs to be defined. And then keeping that goal in mind. My goal is just like this artist who wants to rush back to what he loves to paint, and this seeker who loves to get back to contemplation, to meditation, to reading. It is that abhyasa which Bhagwan says, hold on to that abhyasa. And vairagya, he has already said, by what? How can you hold on to it? Only if you are consistent. Yoga balena. Having said that, we know that our only wealth, what is the outer instrument we have to find God? Scriptures, gurus, texts, reading, listening. Yes, it is still in the outer world. We have to cross that step too. That is a rung of the ladder. But yes, the only inward wealth we have for reaching that God is peace, equipoise, equanimity and silence. And that can't be brought from n number of scriptures and books. And so the only wealth we have for meditation is our own equipoise, our own silence, which we can cultivate. If we haven't cultivated that, no meditation. No meditation means no closeness to God, because the noise of the world is too loud for us to see God clearly. He's always there, of course. That consciousness is always there, but it is obscured. So now, verse 12, Bhagwan gives us a few more tips on how we can reach that Param Tattva a little easier. Number 12, Sarva Dvarani Samyamya Manohridi Nirudhya Cha Murdhyan Dhyatmana Pranam Asthito Yoga Dharanam. So there are only small conditions. What are these small conditions? Sarva Dvarani Samyamya. Dwar is gates, and you know Sarva Dvar, all the gates. What are our gates? All the senses. So the sense of touch and smell and sparsha, and that is of course touch, and sight and sound is all attracting us outward. So in that external stimuli, the mental zone is always turbulent and agitated. Bhagwan is saying, can you in meditation, that is the purpose of meditation, is to close the gates, as I said, to put the shutter down, close shop, counter close, sorry, no transaction today. That's what we tell the world, this 1 hour, no transaction with the world, whether inside our mind or actually. So meditation has a very, very big role to play in acquiring that, or reaching or realizing that highest. Sarva Dvarani Samyaya, close the doors. And then you will have Vivek and Vairagya. Vivek doesn't come with meditation, but when we meditate on what is permanent and impermanent, what is really important to gain and really not so important to gain in life, that distinction, it comes in contemplation. So if we contemplate before we meditate, that Vivek is also required. And that the moment we realize that everything is impermanent, and what am I getting into? So it's like the child who picks up lots of shiny shingles on the seashore and says, oh, I found such a lovely treasure. And for him it is a treasure because they're all shiny little shells and shingles. And by the time he grows up and realizes, oh, what are these? And the moment he realizes as he grows up that he picked up unimportant things, and he just throws it away in one swift moment. He just throws it away. Why? Because in that one moment he realizes that it is trash, it is unimportant. But while he was picking it up, try and dragging him away and try telling him, throw it, it's unimportant. He is going to wail and scream and throw a tantrum. That's what we do. ये घर आपके लिए जरूरी नहीं है, इससे बड़ा जरूरी नहीं है, इतने प्रमोशंस और प्रोजेक्ट्स के पीछे आपका ध्यान जरूरी नहीं है, जितने प्रोजेक्ट्स मिल रहे हैं बिजनेस में ठीक है, वर्क, पुट इन योर 100%, कम बैक टू योरसेल्फ। ये स्क्रिप्चर्स कहते हैं एंड दैट एंड ऑल ऑफ अस हु आर इन्वॉल्वड सो मच इन द वर्ल्ड एंड फैमिली एंड चिल्ड्रन एंड ओ द होल पैराफर्नेलिया ऑफ संसार, वी स्टार्ट थ्रोइंग अ टैंट्रम ऑन द बीच ऑफ संसार एंड सेइंग नो, इट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर मी, आई एम गोइंग टू बी इन्वॉल्वड इन collecting all these pleasures from the sansar, the shiny shingles and shells from the seashore. The moment we read the scriptures, it's like growing up, it's like awakening, it's like waking up and saying, oh yes, I did spend 80 years collecting those shingles, but oops, sorry, they did not hold the value that I thought they did, and finally I'm left with nothing, and therefore I'm in a hurry to get rid of it because it holds no importance. Are we in a position to then open our mind to what is really important and unimportant? Vivek, that is Vivek. And stop seeking and hankering and wanting, and make our mind such in the outer world that we surrender. Surrender. What is coming is good. What's coming naturally to me by way of the peace in the family, the prosperity in the family and the security and wealth and travel, everything is coming to us naturally. Fine. Surrender to it. Not seek and hanker. That's the difference. Otherwise, you slip into a kind of misplaced guilt. Oh, am I going the wrong way? You know, I'm really enjoying the sansar. No. It's a misplaced guilt. He's only saying, surrender to everything, even to the pleasures, but without seeking it. So the mindset in the sansar becomes that of surrender, charity. Let me give away what I have too much of. And forgiveness. What is there to hold on to? Yeah, people have been unfair and unkind and cruel. Okay, that's their vasana, and that is their understanding of life. Forgiveness. If our minds in the sansar have turned to forgiveness and charity and surrender, there is already a sense of calm and peace and distance, vairagya, has been created, and that is a ready ground. That is a rich ground for us to find meditation. A good practice, meditation, a peaceful practice, meditation, a fruitful practice for us to reach our highest tattva. And even in contemplation, we can keep our mind on the highest truth. So either through surrender, charity, forgiveness, and acceptance of whatever is coming from the sansar to me is prasad. That is one way to live. The other is to contemplate what is satya and what is not. So Bhagwan says that I will offer a few more symbols for you to focus on, because the mind and body is such that we need symbols to focus on, because having collected so many shiny shingles and seashells, the worthless pieces which were shiny, no doubt, and attractive on the seashore, our mind is still in that habit of focusing on something. So Bhagwan says, okay, no problem. So number 13. ओमित्येकाक्षरं ब्रह्म व्याहारं मा मनुस्मरन् यः प्रयाति त्यजन् देहं स याति परमां गतिम्. The practice of concentration can most effectively be undertaken and efficiently continued when these three necessary conditions that we have set, sarvadwarani, close the doors, and have vivek and vairagya, three conditions are necessary. Now, apart from these, there is an easier way to focus on something, and that is the Om Akshara. Now, Om, why do you call it Akshar, by the way? We have already said the etymology of the word Akshar is from the Kshar is what is not destructible, and Kshar is what is destructible, and Akshara is what is not destructible. Om is a sound they have in the Vedanta, they have chosen as the Akshara sound, as a symbol of that Akshara, imperishable, indestructible tattva. Okay, so it's a symbol. Now, we have many symbols. So we have idols and we have murtis and we have temples, etc. Yes, that may be necessary for the sthula mind because they are sthula symbols. They are symbols made of tattva, of pancha tattva, of matter. But sound is, om is a sound which is also a symbol, but it is a sound symbol. So sound is a little more sukshma, a little more subtle. So it's a subtler symbol for that same tattva. In order to remember what A, O, it has four sounds of course, A, O, O and Ma. So they have said in order to remember that, remember your four states. What are the four states that we know? The only four states in which we can exist as this body. What are the only four states? It's either Jagrit, waking, or Swapna, dreaming, or Sushupti, deep sleep, or Turiya, deep meditation, Samadhi. Apart from that, do you know any other state in which you can exist? So you may say coma, etc., etc. So all that would go under, you know, it's a bit like deep sleep, where you're not aware of many other things, like in coma, not aware of things, but also not conscious, not consciously awake. So coma would go under that. Okay, so I don't know any other state. So just to make it easy, they said that A stands for your Jagrit Avastha, the U stands for the Swapna, the dream state, just to remember our four states, and Ma stands for Sushupti or deep dream sleep, deep dream state. So then what is that? That ma, which resonates with the nasal sound, is actually stands for silence. So silence is also the symbol of Turiya, Samadhi, the deep meditative state. All right. So if we remember Om as a symbol and we let waves upon wave of Om rise in us, either in a sounded form or unsounded form, unmanifest, unsounded, silently. Om, the waves upon waves in meditation, when we let it rise in us and rise and dissolve into silence with the Om. And then the silence dissolve again into Om. And then the sound dissolve again into silence, Om. There is this magnetic quality in this sound to silence and silence to sound. And in that silent moment, as I said, is where that infinity, that eternal, that where we can touch it, because in that nothing exists, nothing. Some may ask, and scientists of course look for proof all the time, and they say, no, we want to know where you got this sound from. You could have chosen any sound, like what, like Brahma or Tattva or what, Chitta. I mean, all these are sounds, right? But why did you choose Om? What is so special about it? So scientists go about their instruments and their investigation, etc. And guess what they have found? And they have found that when they have put up their instruments out there in the cosmos and close to the sun also, there is a certain emanating sound coming out from the sun. Because sun, the surface of it, as you know, it is a lot of nuclear fission and fusion going on. Yes, it's a lot of nuclear activity going on, the heat that is produced because of the fission and fusion of the heat particles. That is all the activity on the sun's surface, scientifically speaking. And on the surface, around the sun, they found that there is a sound emanating, and it is akin to, and they have recorded it. You'll find some videos on it. It is akin to the sound Om. Believe it or not, it is akin to the sound Om. Another theory, and also being tested out, is that when the Srishti came into existence with the Big Bang, that is, the Big Bang theory, of course, is scientifically proved. So the moment they put their instruments out there, they found that with that Big Bang, there is a reverberation of a certain sound. Because there is no, because there's a vacuum in cosmos, and therefore sound does not destroy, it just reverberates continuously for eternity, or at least for as long as the Srishti is there. And in that vacuum, the sound continues as Om. It is that sound which is reverberating. So what about me? So when I sit in silence and I tune in my mind and my body and my sound symbol, Om, it is a kind of union that is created with a lot of repetition. As time comes when there is a complete union between me, this body, mind, intellect, which dissolves into that sound and the silence that follows between the two Om sounds, the silence. So I actually, as a meditator or a person in Samadhi, will dissolve in that Om sound and silence. That dissolution is called the union with that Param Tattva. Because that Param Tattva exists in cosmos and in us too and around us too. Just as it is around the surface of the sun, it is around us too. And therefore, we can say that union with that Param Tattva takes place. We can achieve that highest truth in an experience, as an experience, not through words, not through logic, which Vedanta follows logic and words and scriptures also, but in as an experience, it's possible through Samadhi, deep meditation. So it's most important. Slowly what happens, as we go deeper and deeper into that sound and into the silence between the two sounds, we are getting detached, slowly detached, more and more detached from our false matter identity. Our matter identity is only Man, Buddhi, Ahankar and body, Deha. So that's how it is meant to take place once we get into meditation. What about mantra? Mantra is also a very powerful medium, which is now being tested out by science. How is it that mantra, the chanting of certain things like Om Namah Shivaya or Hare Ram, Hare Krishna, why is it that mantra, any mantra, has been able to affect the quality of the mind? That's simple, because mantras are power packed. The words have been used in such a way that they are packed with the power to explode into silence and into the meaning of that phrase. So Om Namah Shivaya is expected to get you closer to that Shivaya Tattva. If we concentrate on the meaning. If we are concentrating only on the sound, it is still okay. Why? Because the science has already told us that any sound that is made, it actually displaces something in space, right? So there are sound vibrations, which we call vibrations. The displacement of that something with any sound is actually a vibration. So these vibrations, and Germany has done the maximum research on this, saying that Om Namah Shivaya and also the Gayatri Mantra. They researched the most on Gayatri Mantra. Om Bhur Bhuvasvaha Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yona Prachodayat. Do it 1,000 times, and they researched and they found that the vibrations that are created, every sound creates a vibration basically, not only mantras, but the vibrations are created by the way the words have been ordered and strung together in Gayatri Mantra, and those vibrations create a certain kind of dynamism in the room and in the personality and in the people and in the minds of those who are chanting, because they've also done brain research. So I'm quoting science, saying that Gayatri Mantra, being the most powerful of all the mantras, has been able to alter the state of the mind. I have talked about neuroplasticity, which is a part of science now, brain science. Neuroplasticity is that we are able to change the construction and the chemistry of our brains through thought, contemplation, which is also actually neuron firing. Thoughts are nothing but neurons firing, which is a vibration, or you can call it energy being fired. And sound is also that form of vibration energy. So both these can alter the chemistry of our brains. I have quoted only and only science so far to bring home the point that meditation and the sound of Om is not just a mystic symbol, or the mantra is not just a mystic symbol. It has certain properties. They carry some properties. If you will notice, the sound of A and M, that nasal M, are common. When we say a prayer in Christianity, we end it with Amen. Amen. So that A, M, and the N, the nasal ending sound, is common. When we say a prayer in Islam, we end it with Ameen. If you make a wish and say, oh, I wish this would happen to me, someone close to you says, Ameen. May this be so. May the grace of God bring it to truth. Yes. So there are vibrations in the world that can bring our thoughts to truth, to reality. And therefore, that's how some miracle cures have taken place in cases of cancer patients and also kidney patients. And that, all that is proven and published. These are well-published research pieces that I'm quoting. So it's not a coincidence that the same sounds are occurring. Amen, Ameen, Om. The same sound vibrations are occurring over and over again. Having said that, let's see in 14 what Bhagwan says, how we need to approach this. I'll end with that. अनन्यचेतः सततं यो मां स्मरति नित्यशः तस्याहं सुलभः पार्थ नित्ययुक्तस्य योगिनः. Bhagwan says, I am easily attainable. Are you ready for it? Are you doing the practice of it? I am available, provided you are. And Bhagwan's favorite words are satatam and nitya. Nityashah satatam. N number of times these words will occur and recur in through Bhagavad Gita. And you might say, oh, he is repeating it ad nauseum, ad infinitum. Yes, he will repeat it ad nauseum, because we are unable to understand the import of the word satatam, be steadfast in that practice. And nityashah, be continuous and constant in that practice. He says, without that, I cannot even promise you anything. These are not magic bullets, the magic silver bullet. Say Om 100 times and you are there. No, I cannot offer you any magic bullet. So here you are. Again, satatam nityashah. Are you ready for that divine practice in a steadfast way? So more about this